Okay, thank you, Karen. So first, let me thank the organizers for giving me not only the possibility to give a talk on some specific research aspect in my group, but more giving a tutorial, an introduction in this POD method by also having some research, new research result in this talk. So it's to those of you who are familiar with POD, there are some slides where I have some maybe new material also for you. And so it's a great pleasure to be here and start the talk. So the title is clear. This work is, okay, not my own work. It's done by several colleagues at my university in Konstanz, but also with collaborators which are here or which wanted to be here and are not here, like Karl Kunisch, and a PhD student from Rome, from the group of Maurizio Falcone. But of course, also this work is influenced by the whole work which is done in this field. There are quite a lot of workers in this POD, or let's say suboptimal control area. And of course, there are some ideas which carry over in my research aspects and research results. So I have four parts and a concluding part. The first part is where I introduced my POD setting, okay, the POD setting. And the second part is where I used this POD method to derive reduced order models, POD reduced order models for dynamical systems, especially for partial differential equations, what I have in mind. And I used this reduced order models in the context of PDE constraint optimization, as the title of the tutorial suggests. So I start first with what is usually the case when you go for nonlinear programming. You start with quadratic problems. So we start with linear quadratic problems and investigate the POD, or let's say more general, the Galerkin type approximation schemes. We consider the error and we take these ideas over to the fourth part, because quadratic programming problems play an essential role also in nonlinear programs when you apply, for example, Newton-Kantorovich theorem, what we have seen yesterday, where you have to solve linear quadratic problems in each iteration. But the other word, which is, of course, there's some equivalence when you go for SQP, sequential quadratic programming method. And I will stop with some conclusions and give you some outlook, also to give some points to talks which will be today, or to posters which you can see, I think, tomorrow. There's the poster session, or today, yeah, so it's perfect. Okay, so let's start with proper orthogonal decomposition. Maybe some, most, all of you know. POD is a method to derive the reduced order model, or to derive first a basis which is used to build up a reduced order model. And I discussed two variants of this method. I discussed a so-called discrete variant and also a continuous variant. And starting with the discrete one, which is the one which is usually behind POD when you look for SVD and so on, we will see this correspondence. We see how to compute it efficiently. We do this POD application in our special case for dynamical systems, so also for evolution problems. We look for linear evolution problems here. And then I say something, what is behind this discrete variant? So why I call this POD method a discrete variant, because I look also for a continuous variant, and you, of course, can see here already the two variants which are often, we are often referred during the talk to. So, okay. So let's start. So I think you have so-called snapshot, which means you have some elements in a Hilbert space, X. X is my Hilbert space. So I need an inner product here. So I have a space with an inner product, and I have, let's say, several sets of snapshots. So J corresponds to this, to one snapshot set where you have this enumeration over this J, and then you have this multiple snapshots, and we will use this later on for the error analysis, that you put in more than only one snapshot set. So, and then I have a subspace which is spanned by this snapshots. And the idea of POD is to look for a POD basis, to look for an orthonormal basis which approximates this snapshot good as possible, which means you want to take only a few of them to get a low error. And this is defined here in this minimization problem. So if you look here at this norm, you see here you have each snapshot. And what you have here is nothing else but an lth partial Fourier sum of this snapshot. So if you take D, which is the dimension of this set, then this here gives you a cancels out, it gives you zero, and everything is done. So the idea is to choose an L, which is in most cases much smaller than the dimension D, and therefore you get a basis approximation with only using a few basis elements. And this, in fact, when you look for the second part, gives you a reduced order, a low-dimensional approximation. So what you also see here are, okay, we have some alpha j here, so some average, no? We have some average over the snapshots, and we also encounter all snapshot sets here by putting this sum in front of the whole minimization process. Okay, we call a solution to this minimization problem a POD basis of rank L, and what we also use is a projection operator, which do nothing else but taking an element in our Hilbert space and project it in our snapshot, in our set, which is spanned by the first L POD basis, which you get as a solution from this. So it is given by this L partial sum. Of course, this is this sum what you have here, and you can use this to write a more compact form of this cost functional by inserting here this projection operator. But of course, the projection operator, this is a little bit hidden if you use this formula instead of this. This projection operator depends on the POD basis and therefore from the solution of the minimization problem. But it gives you a compact notation. We will also use this PL further, or later, so let's say further. Again, this is nothing else but the previous problem, yeah? And what you can also do is you can formulate the POD problem not as a minimization problem for this partial Fourier sum, you can also formulate it as a maximization problem for the Fourier coefficients. And the idea is nothing else but you take this this norm here, and you use that you have orthonormal that you are looking for an orthonormal basis, and then you get nothing else but this expression here. Okay, but this is not influenced by the optimization. There's no psi. These are the fixed snapshots, and what you have here is nothing else but the Fourier coefficients. So the projection of the snapshot yjk onto the ith basis function, and here you have a sum. So what you look here is a minimization. Okay, you can also maximize this sum. So we replace this norm here by this sum which we have here, and you end up here with a maximization problem. Yeah, there is also a technical issue that handling this maximization problem is a little bit less complicated than taking this problem. So what we do now is we want to solve this problem, and to solve this problem we go for the Lagrange functional and try to derive first order optimality conditions. Because what we have here, look at this, you have a cost functional and you have constraints here due to this orthonormality conditions, and therefore we have such kind of Lagrange function. Here the cost function, here you have the constraints, and I sum it up by taking this Lagrange multiplier here. Okay, I repeat it on the next slide. So again, here's this POD problem, and here you have the Lagrange function. And before you go for this classical derivation for the first order conditions, you have to check that there are Lagrange multipliers exist. Otherwise, you set up something, you call it first order necessary optimality condition, and they are not. So therefore, you have to check that your constraints satisfy some regularity conditions. And that can be done. I do not formulate it here. So what you do is you take this is my constraints, you linearize this constraints, and look that this operator gives you some regularity conditions, and you can prove it here, and therefore you can go like the standard theory. So you say, okay, let's suppose there exists a solution, then this solution is characterized by first order optimality conditions. Here you have the derivative with respect to each basis function. Here you have the derivative with respect to the Lagrange multipliers. This is the Lagrange function. Here again, here you have the Lagrange function. And what we see here, there is an additional variable, which is the associated Lagrange multiplier. And therefore, you have an equation which can be solved, and you get some solution from it. And then, of course, you have to check that the psi is the solution of the problem. So let's first go for this first order optimality conditions. What are the form for our problem? Because what we have in mind is we not only want to have a nice optimization problem here, we also want to have a method to compute this basis easily. Otherwise, it is maybe something which is interesting for theoretical issues, but not for practical issues. So is it easy to compute the basis to solve this optimization problem? So therefore, we go for the optimality conditions. Again, here you have the problem, the minimization problem. Here you have the first order conditions. And what I do now is, okay, I already replace the derivative with respect to the Lagrange multipliers by the constraints. This is nothing what is surprising. So the derivative with respect to the Lagrange multipliers gives you nothing else but the equality constraint of your problem. Of course, this is a necessary condition for a solution to PL hat. Okay, and to formulate this, one has to do with this derivation, so you need some lines for it, especially in this case where you have alpha j here, you have a summation here. So I skip this linear algebra computations here and formulate it as a theorem. Okay, so let us suppose we have a separable Hilbert space, especially if x is nothing else, we will have it on maybe the next or the slide later. If this is Rm, Euclidean space, this is nothing what is complicated. Okay, so then we have this R. This operator R is defined by this summation. Okay, what we see here is, okay, psi enters here. It is an element of x, so this is an operator from x, giving an element of x because we suppose that the snapshots are elements in x in the Hilbert space. Okay, you have a finite summation here. This is a finite rank operator. Of course, it is compact. And linear, we also have that it is self-adjoint and non-negative. Therefore, this eigenvalue problem for this operator is a symmetric, well-defined problem. Okay, so the optimality condition, so this condition can be written as an eigenvalue problem by taking the first L, so the biggest one, eigenvalues and the corresponding eigenfunctions. And the eigenfunctions you get here are the solution to this problem. Here, of course, is something behind. This is some solution which you get only from the first order conditions. You have to check that this is really a solution. And to check this, what you have to do is, you go for second order sufficient conditions, but that is not a good idea here. You don't get any result here because you have only positive semi-definiteness of this operator. Therefore, the other idea is to just compare. So you say, take another orthonormal basis, insert it in the cost functional, and you get a lower value. Okay, so that is what you get here in C. And then there is something which is of main interest for us. It's not new, because you also have it in SVD. But what we see here is, if you have this solution, you also have the eigenvalues. And this eigenvalues gives you some interesting information. You get a value of this cost by inserting the optimal solution in this way, that this is given by the sum over the lambda I. These are the biggest one, and we want to maximize. So we get here the sum over the first L, greatest L, eigenvalues, or vice versa. If you look for the second variant, or what we introduced first, this is the Lth partial Fourier sum. We subtract it from the snapshots. There, this is something what we minimize, and here we get this value, which means we sum over the eigenvalues, which corresponds to the modes we are not using in the POD mode. So if this is decaying very fast, this is very small. And then the next thing is, okay, what we want to have is that this is small if L is small. If you have to take a big L to get a small value for this, then your problem is probably not appropriate for POD. And this is, maybe I should say it at the beginning, if you present something, it seems like the method of everything. POD is a method which you can apply for certain problem where you have certain structure. It is not a method for everything. Good luck. No? So there's still some work to do. No? Okay, so that is what we have here. So let's go on the next slide. Again, this is the problem. I switch now not to the maximization, to the minimization problem. I repeat, we can solve this by solving the eigenvalue problem. This is an eigenvalue problem in the Hilbert space X. Again, here I have this approximation quality. And as we said, if for L smaller than the dimension, we get that this is small, so then we have a good approximation quality. In practical computations, what is usually done in applications, in papers that you can see, is that they look at some quantity, which I wrote here, some quantity of interest. So what they do is they take this first L eigenvalues and divide it over the sum. And if this is something like 99%, then it's maybe fine. We will see that this is some issue. This is something which gives you a hint for this L. But of course, this is not the quantity which is the only characterization of the error. What you can do further, this is here on the here, what you can see here on the denominator is that you can replace this sum by this quantity. And what is behind here is, of course, we want to solve this problem by maybe an iterative solution method. And therefore, we only compute the first L eigenvalues and not the eigenvalues from L plus 1 up to D. And therefore, we can avoid this by replacing this by this quantity, because this is known. These are my snapshots. You only set up this norm, let's say. And then you can compute this. OK. I have some general formulation of this problem. Let's go to some specific cases. And the first specific case is I take Euclidean space. I take the Euclidean space, and I say, OK, I only have one snapshot set. Therefore, I have n vectors. Now, I have n vectors. I have this x. I build a matrix like this. This is m by n. And I take this weights. We will discuss this weights later on. But I take alpha j equal 1. Then this problem, which I have here also, breaks down to this. So I want to minimize this. Also this L partial sum of this vector. Now I have this, also these are vectors. Here I have this Euclidean inner product. This is my inner product in Rm, in this Euclidean space. What is the summation operator in this case? It is of this form. It is of this form. You have the inner product of this psi with this snapshot, and I multiply this quantity, this real number, with this vector. But this can be written in this form. And then we see, okay, the eigenvalue problem is nothing else but this symmetric eigenvalue problem for the matrix YY transpose. YY transpose is a good matrix, let's say, symmetric, positive, semi-definite, non-negative. So here we have the first L eigenvalues. And of course, here I suppose something that L is bigger than the rank of this, that L is smaller than the rank of this matrix. And now we see this eigenvalue problem is related to a singular value decomposition. And therefore, you find in books also POD is something like SVD or some generalization of of SVD. So you set up this singular value decomposition we have seen also yesterday. And there you have matrices psi and you have matrices phi. Here you have orthonormal columns and here also. And these columns directly give you the solution of this problem. And the sigma i's, the singular values, you have to compute the square of it, and you get the lambda i's from this eigenvalue problem. OK, so we see here we have this problem. This is, we see here, especially if m, the number, this corresponds to my Hilbert space, to the length of the snapshot is smaller than the number of columns, I solve this eigenvalue. Vice versa, if n is smaller than m, then I go to this a related symmetric eigenvalue problem. And when I compute this phi I bars, which are nothing else but the columns of this matrix, I can use the singular value decomposition to compute the psi. No? So here's nothing else. Psi I is given by y phi bar divided by sigma I, and I can compute the psi. And of course, you can also go for the singular value decomposition, especially if you have problems with respect to stability. Here, for this eigenvalue problem, you have to compute this matrix product. This can, of course, influence the stability of the eigenvalue problem. Also, the computation of this product is maybe a not so easy task. No? Okay. So POD and SVD are related, and some people maybe at the moment see that is nothing else but POD. Okay, so let's do a next step from this Euclidean space, taking a weighted inner product. Okay, so I stay in the Euclidean space. I also use the one set of snapshots, but in addition, I have a weighted inner product. So the beginning is the same. I have again this matrix. Now I have this inner product here. There's a matrix W, and I pose that this is a symmetric positive definite matrix. Again, I formulate this problem here for this case. So that means for the inner product, I write not an X, but a W. And here I mean nothing else but this inner product here. I have no sum in front because I only have one snapshot ensemble. And then I can also look for the summation operator in this case, and it is similar to the previous one. It looks like this. So we have a y, d, y transpose, and then a w. So this d corresponds to the alphas, which we have here, né, to this weight. So which means we have in this space Rn, né, this corresponds to the columns, a different inner product. And this different inner product is given by this alpha j's, by this weighting, by this weights, no? And therefore we see here's some kind of inner product. But also we have this W here, of course, if we have here an inner product, it should influence my eigenvalue problem. So I end up with this matrix. And at the moment it seems that this is not a symmetric thing, but we have to check symmetry with respect to our inner product, what we are using. And the idea is, okay, we can formulate it as a symmetric eigenvalue problem. And let's look at the solution. It looks like this. So this is similar to the previous one. But what we see here is there's a y hat instead of the y here. So how to compute this y hat? Okay, there is a formula here. And we see, okay, there is this y involved. There is some weighting from this. Okay, this is easy because this is only the diagonal matrix of the square roots. But probably this is, we can write it, but probably this is difficult, no? Because it comes from the inner product here. Think of a mass matrix. You are an L2, you discretize L2, finite elements. You end up with a mass matrix. Then this mass matrix is a candidate for this W, and you have to compute the square root of this. This is maybe not an easy task, especially in large dimensions. Okay, so, but anyway, we have, in fact, the solution that we solve this problem. If we can solve this, then you get the psi I bars. The psi I bars are the solution to this problem. You get them by multiplying with W minus 1/2, or in fact here you also have to solve a problem. No? So here you don't invert this. Maybe if this is a diagonal matrix, you can go for the inverse, but usually you have to solve here. And here, in this case, singular value helps you to identify that there is a chance to solve. It depends on your setting, what is W, and what is the dimension, what is M, what is N, so what is the relation between both. So therefore, you can use the singular value decomposition to derive the corresponding symmetric eigenvalue problem y hat transpose, y hat. Okay, and what's going on? So we take, of course, this y hat here, and then what you see, it has this form. And especially in this setting, this d 1/2, we already mentioned it here. This is easily to be computed. But here we have the situation that the w arises, but not some W 1/2. So here is no W in this eigenvalue problem. Okay, this is the first good result, but we need a further one, because this is only for the eigenvalue problem. From the eigenvalue problem, we get a phi, and then we have to use singular value decomposition to get the psi. Maybe we get a W something there, but the good news are there's a second advantage of this approach, that when you look at this problem, you get the psi i's, you can directly compute this psi I hat, the solution to this problem, by this formula, okay? And we see here is di 1/2, okay, but we don't have any w here. It cancels out in this formula, okay. So singular value decomposition helps here to derive a formula which is in some applications better to solve than you solving this problem. But it depends on the application. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, if you take W equal to identity and D equal to identity, you end up with the previous slide. Yeah, thanks for the comment. No? So the extension, if you take this D, then of course here, look at this, you get here, identity, you have Y here, and therefore you have here Y, Y transpose. Yeah, thanks for this comment, because then I can emphasize this. So this is the extension is now we have some weighting with respect to the columns, and we have weighting with respect to the columns. This is the inner product in X, but we also have this weighting with respect to N by this alpha J's. What is the extension if we take here more than one? Okay, then we have to, this is okay, more involved now, but what we have to do is for each of the snapshot set, we have to set up matrices of the, you have several times, in fact p times, you have to compute these matrices, you have to sum it up and multiply by w. Okay. Good. Nonlinear system. So up to now we have this Euclidean space. Now I go to the dynamical system. So I look for an application where I have a time variable. And I write it in this abstract form. Later on, we will go to evolution problems. And in this lecture, I concentrate on linear, because there will be, Dan will give today, that's also this dime talk. So we will have several talks on this, how to treat the nonlinearity. And I shift it there to the expert. We use this, and I focus here only on this linear things to indicate the things more and to keep it more on the focus. Okay, so we have a dynamical system in a Hilbert space X. It can be Rm after discretizing your partial differential equation, after discretizing your parabolic equation, but it can also be a system in now an infinite dimensional setting. So we have a dynamical system in some Hilbert space X. Okay, I also indicate probably you also have some parameters in the system. Now, this is some link to the reduced basis community dealing with first with elliptic problems, parameter dependent, and then turning to the evolution problems. And to make this step, there is also this famous POD greedy approach, where you mix this greedy approximation with respect to the parameter with the POD method for the time evolution. So, okay, so therefore I have also this mu here to indicate this dependence or this relationship to reduced basis work in this field. Okay, let us suppose, no, so okay, you need some assumptions that there is a solution. I do not write it for this abstract problem. No, therefore, because it is something, okay, you need some Lipschitz continuity of this F, you need some derivative information. So, but let's take here the assumption, we suppose that there exists a solution to the problem, okay? And the idea now is when you compute a numerical solution to this, you don't have this, but what you have is maybe by your integrator, you get a time grid. Now you get a time grid, and on this time grid you get approximations of this solution of this problem to a certain parameter mu k. So therefore we take a grid in the parameter domain, and I compute solution to this problem on this grid, and I get this yjk. And the yjk carry over to the snapshots. No? Okay, here they are. No? This is now an example to get a snapshot for this dynamical system. This is nothing else but the problem I wrote in the beginning. No? So you have this minimization problem. And the question now for me is in this aspect is we haven't attacked this alpha j's. What is a good idea to take for the alpha j's, and where should I take my snapshots here? No? So my snapshot, what are good time instances to choose for this POD procedure? Okay, and an idea to treat this problem, there are some other ideas also, goal-oriented and so on. But here I look for this idea. So I write a so-called continuous variant of the POD, okay? And this means, okay, suppose that you have the whole trajectory. Now, this is, of course, something which is an ideal situation. Suppose you have it, yeah? And what you have it on this grid, okay? So therefore, I have snapshots yk, and the k corresponds to this parameter mu k, okay? But now, since I have the solution for all times, I can set up an integral here, okay? So I want to fit my trajectory for the parameter mu k by this L partial sum. Of course, in this you don't see the alpha anymore, and if you compare, okay, you get some idea. This is nothing else but a quadratic rule for this problem. Yeah.
Why do you want the same
time with yeah, okay. Yeah, okay. So, okay, so you can also have, but then you can also go this way, but it is much more complicated to make the notations. You are correct. If you take a different parameter, put it in your ODE solver, then usually you get different grids for all of this. No? So, okay, so thanks for the comment. So, as you indicate, there are some things which are ideal, no, of course, but maybe it's the idea is to focus it, to have the idea what's going on, but behind one line there can be massive scientific computing, of course. No? Okay, so there can be several ones. Therefore, you would have some alpha JKs here, no? But it carries over. No? Okay, so we have this form, and as I indicated, there is some quadratic rule. No? That is what you see here. And the idea is to investigate this, and that is what we do here. No? So, okay, again, dynamical system. I have this multiple snapshots. I suppose I have the whole trajectory. And I span this, I build this subset here, the span over this trajectories for the parameters mu 1 to mu k, mu p. I have this continuous variant of this POD problem. And what I do now is I formulate the Lagrange function for this problem. Okay? You can use infinite dimensional nonlinear optimization to go in this direction. And therefore, you have something like this. Okay, this is my cost functional, and here you have the constraints. The constraints are the same as in the here's a discrete case, as here. But you have to deal with this formulation here. But let me mention also in the beginning, I presented this theorem for the discrete variant. Also in this case, X is some Hilbert space, so it can also be infinite dimensional. Okay, we had these examples where X is Rm, but it can also be infinite dimensional. What is more complicated here is that in the continuous variant, look at this here, the operator Rn is built by this, and so it's a finite rank operator. This need not to be the case for the operator which I define here. No? Therefore, the situation is a little bit more complicated, but in fact it is solved. You can, for example, take the book of Kato and look for the perturbation theory, and that is what we do. Okay, so we investigate this problem. For this you get, this is the operator for the eigenvalue problem, and we compare this with the operator here, and we see, okay, the corresponding is S for the cost functional here. It directly gives you a quadratic rule of this operator. Okay, let's go further. Again, continuous variant here. I have this operator, and here's a discrete one. And what you can prove is that under certain regularity assumptions for this Y, you have that this is a linear compact self-adjoint non-negative operator. You have X is separable, so you have a complete basis of the space by taking the eigenfunctions of this operator. You have some convergence properties of these eigenvalues, but you don't have that maybe due to the, you have maybe infinite rank, so therefore all of them can be greater than zero, but in the limit that is zero, you have that the solution to this problem also solves this PL infinity, okay, this problem here. And you also end up with this formula, so it also indicates that the proof is more or less similar. And the regularity conditions for this Y enter especially on this slide, or on this line. What you need is, you need operator convergence to have some claims for the first L, so finite number of eigenvalues or eigenfunctions. Okay, and the idea now is, okay, if we can ensure this convergence, then we have that this the discrete eigenvalues converge to the continuous one. And this is something which we which we interpret in such a way, okay, we choose alpha j to be trapezoidal weights. You can also choose Simpson, whatever. No? So you stay with some quadratura rule. And what, of course, you need, if you go further here, maybe you need some more information here, so which means you meet more regularity on this Y, so it depends on the problem. But trapezoidal is enough to have this result, and therefore we get something, okay, keep in mind, the people look for the eigenvalues and their decay to get an information how many basis functions they should take. But of course, these eigenvalues depend on the grids you have chosen, and probably you choose the grids so in a poor fashion that you get maybe very fast decaying eigenvalues, but they don't. There's not the information of the infinite dimensional structure behind. That is what is the message here on this in this theory. These are my assumptions. Okay, in the case x is equal Rm, no, then it is then you have here nothing else but m. But if you have that x is, for example, L2, then I say, okay, you have a complete basis by eigenfunctions of this space. And this is so, then there is infinity. This is, you get this, it's hidden, but you need that they are separated. Otherwise, it's you have to clarify. They are solid eigenvalues. What helps here is that not in all cases, but in many cases, you have this decay, so different eigenvalues at the beginning. Especially if you enter the area where you have the eigenvalues very close to zero, this is difficult to this issue, but this is also difficult to other issues. Yeah? Okay, one idea, to give you one idea, is I look here for a PDE system of this type. So we have diffusion term here, time dependent, so you have this dynamical system. This is my F here. And what I have here is nothing else but some rotation matrix. No? Here I have 1 minus S. This lambda and omega is given by this parameter beta times S, and beta is the parameter which is crucial in this application. We can consider this system with different boundary conditions, Dirichlet or Neumann, and what you get is taking some certain initial condition, is what you see here. So this is beta equal to 1, 2, and 3 taking Dirichlet conditions. And this is, for example, to get an idea, if you take Neumann conditions, this figure has to be replaced by this. So what I want to show here is some issue where you see that probably this idea what we are doing here, applying POD to the system sample and so on, depends on the problem, so it depends here on this beta. Let's have a look at the decay of the eigenvalues for this problem, okay? So again, I have here this dynamical system, I have this boundary condition, so this is Dirichlet, this is Neumann. And I look for the first eigenvalues for this problem, and you see here, looking at this parameter beta, you see that in the case if beta is small, which means here beta is 1, you have this nice decay here. They are, by the way, they are normalized. Therefore, we start here somewhere in close to 1. So you have this nice decay here taking 30 eigenvalues to somewhere here below 10 to the, to the power of minus 10 for the normalized eigenvalues. And if you increase this beta, you see the decay is not as fast, and you see some effects which are also known when you look for Navier-Stokes and you play around with the Reynolds number, and you have turbulent flow. So there is something like turbulence, and you also see this chaotic behavior which starts here. No? The same is the case for the Neumann boundary conditions. Also here, beta 1, here 1.5, 2, and 3, and here you have this kind of decay. Okay, probably this is already still okay. This depends on the application. I cannot say that 10 to the power of minus 5 is good. So it depends on the problem you are dealing with. So the decay of the eigenvalue is a critical issue for the application of PUD.
So how does this decay of the eigenvalues depend on the alpha j, on the weights you have chosen, on the number of stations in time where you sample?
Yeah, here I fixed, I have a fixed grid. This issue is not considered here. So you mean varying this snapshot, this time grid, and looking for the eigenvalues, no? Yeah, this result, what you get here, is not surprising. So therefore, if you play around with this grid, in this case, you will get this more or less the same pictures. No, because this is something, you know that if beta is the parameter which makes the system, in this case, more chaotic. Okay. And therefore, it is not a surprising result for people working in this lambda omega field. And that was the idea that there was a guy in Graz, this Alfio Borzi, he was working on this, and we just make this test for the POD approximation to get some investigation of the, some information for the decay, and does it correspond to the observation that we have more and more chaotic behavior. And it's just for the tutorial here to give the idea, okay, the decay depends on like Reynolds number or something like this turbulent behavior. And by the way, this investigation, of course, now you can go more in this direction, is used in engineering science. There are a lot of people, Mannhardt and so on, I remember, that they are investigating, for example, Navier-Stokes with very high Reynolds number, and they look for the modes, they look like the energy goes from one mode to the other, and they use POD in this case. Okay, but of course, in this case, you have to be careful, to use careful the numerical scheme. Okay, so up to now, I listened this discrete and continuous variant. I investigate the relationship between both. I mentioned that there is a singular value decomposition which has the relation to the POD, so let's say a generalized singular value decomposition. And I discussed the application to the dynamical systems. I haven't given too much references up to now, but of course, let me mention POD is something which is not from yesterday. It's an old field. No? So look at this. You have this work from Karhune Löwe, and therefore also you have this name, Karhune Löwe decomposition in stochastic. You have this name, principal component analysis in statistics, and you have this SVD from numerical linear algebra, and the differences are given by the focus what you have. We have in focus and Galerkin-type approximation, so we will look for a priori area estimate by applying Galerkin techniques. Of course, in statistics, using principal component analysis, there are different tasks. But what is behind is nothing else but what is POD. And okay, I also mentioned that there is this nice work of Lal and co-authors where they investigate the POD as an extension of balanced truncation. Yeah? And there are some other works like Raleigh, where using some balancing POD method to also include some system theoretic information in the POD basis. I will not touch this, otherwise it's like a lecture for the whole day. And That is okay, but I would like to mention that there are quite a lot of work. Also, you find the relations in this book of Antulas, and especially this balancing POD method is now also included in this second variant. There's a pre-earlier book. This is 96, I guess, 96 from Holmes, Lumley, and Bercos. But now we have there's a second edition available, and there's an extra section or subsection on this balancing POD methods. Of course, you know, he's an co-author of this book. Okay. What I presented here is something which is partially from papers we wrote together in Graz, so some time ago, where we investigate this POD method, more or less in the time beginning to work on POD. So that is maybe the initial dates, like 98. Okay. Yeah.
So my question is, in principal component analysis, the statisticians insist that the data is mean adjusted, mean zero. And so have you seen that play any role in the POD?
Can I continue? Mm-hmm. I have some address of this.
Okay.
I continue, and then you see that there is some aspect which I discuss now in this going to the a priori estimation.
Thank you.
Yeah, okay. And probably if it's not answered, then I encourage you, ask again, okay? Okay, let's go to the reduced order modeling. So we have computed a POD basis and I want to apply it for an evolution problem. I want to have some knowledge on the a priori error. So when I apply this, is there some chance if I include more and more basis functions that the error goes down? And I want to have a rate of convergence results and we will see. Okay, so now I start with a dynamic, with an evolution problem. Let's start here. So this is my evolution problem, okay? It's written in this abstract form. A is a bilinear form satisfying standard assumptions for linear problems. So we have continuity, we have coercivity here. Okay, then there is a solution space, which is spent by such Bochner spaces here. And of course, to have some link to the next section is here I have the control input, which at the moment is fixed. So I have some U and solve the equation. But we go further in the next slide, next section, to control control problems. And there, of course, we have again this equation, and then U is a variable. Okay. So this is something you can find in books. So this is a linear problem, well-defined. A is nice. You have for F everything what is needed to have a variational solution to this problem. And you also have some estimate like this. So this C is independent on this data. And especially, we will later on use that it is independent of U. And therefore, the solution operator will be well-defined and is bounded. Okay. So again, the linear problem, okay. And now I go in, prepare myself a little bit in the direction of your question. What is often done in PDE analysis for this smooth problem is that they introduce particular solutions. And the particular solution is, in this case, a solution to this problem where I have the right-hand side F and I have the initial condition fixed. So I don't have this U term. So I want to have this splitting. A part of the solution depends on the U variable, and a part of the solution depends on the data. In this case, I say initial condition and right-hand side F is fixed. It can be different that Y0 is the control input. Then you should go for a different formulation of the particular solution, okay? So and then I introduce the control to state map here, and this is nothing else, but now I have zero initial conditions, and I keep this right-hand side. Then, in this case, you can write the solution of this problem by a sum. No? This particular solution plus this linear operator part, and you have a so-called affine linear representation of the solution. Okay, and you can, to have everything in some nice functional analysis, you can improve the regularity on the data to get some, also on this B here, to have some example where you have additional regularity for the state, because what we later on want to use is Y of T as a snapshot, and from this we get that Y of T is an element in V, so we can take, in this case, instead of X, V space also. Okay. So, I can take H and V. So let's take one snapshot, and this snapshot is only the homogeneous solution part, the control, by the control input. Here I have this snapshot space, and I look for nothing else. Now I take this continuous variant here. I don't have any sum here. And so, therefore, I have this formula. The integral operator is of this type. It is like I repeat it from the first part. And when you solve this problem, you have, again, this quantity here. Right? You have this quantity here. And now I have some issue here. Now, okay, this is some measure which gives me the information that maybe POD is good. So if you have fast decay here. But what does it mean if you look at the formula again? It only gives an information for the approximation of the snapshot. It does not give you any information on the reduced order solution. So you derive a reduced order model, you get a solution from that. And this is no information you have here. And therefore, in contrast to reduced Bayes, there is a need for a priori analysis in POD to have the information that this, in fact, gives you a rate which also arises in the error estimation for the solution of the, for the difference of solution of the full solution and the low-dimensional solution. Okay. And again, here also I want here some issue I also want to mention. I formulate this in V. You can also go for the discrete spaces. The notation is a little bit more heavy. So I stay here with the finite infinite dimensional case. But in practice, usually you have this finite element spaces and you, or finite volume or whatever, and you build your reduced order model on that. Yeah, and then, of course, you have some more indices here. So to keep it more clear, I stay with the infinite dimensional case. And also, I want to keep the structure. No? Okay. Again, linear solution. A linear evolution problem. I have this particular solution. I have the control part, let's say. And now from this, I also make an ansatz for the POD solution. The idea is now, okay, in the control problem, this part is fixed in every case, but what is changing is probably the U. And so I make this ansatz of this form here, fixed data, and here the part which comes from the control input. What I, in addition, have is that YL satisfy my initial condition exactly. Because now this Y0 is here the initial condition for the particular solution. So, and for the SLU, I have zero conditions. Therefore, we have that this is exactly satisfied. Okay, when we go for this, then the question is, what can we say about the error of these quantities?
When you take x equal to v, in fact, what you will construct the complete basis of h with your strategy.
If you, again, at the beginning,
if you take x is equal to v,
yeah,
okay, you will construct the basis of v. If you take x equal to h, which makes sense given the abstract regularities that you use, then you only obtain a basis of h. So then you cannot have a conforming Galerkin approximation.
Yeah.
Okay. So in practice.
I get these results only for the V case.
Ah, for the V case, okay.
And there are results also for the H case, but especially you don't get any rate of convergence results. It's not possible.
Okay. So you need more regularity than the abstract setting initially introduced. Okay.
Okay, if you have this here, you can, of course, take the H space, because in this case, if you have this, due to the definition of the R operator, also you have regularity results for the psi i's. You will obtain a. No, it is first. It is a basis with respect to. So it is orthonormal with respect to the H inner product. To show that it is a. Yeah, yeah, but this is the H case is more involved. Mm-hmm. Here we are. Yes, no? Here we are. No? Okay, so is this what? No, we are here. So, linear evolution problem, particular solution. Yeah, no, we are here. So, that is, we look for the error. Okay, so Y1 is this SU. Okay, you have here nothing else but this formula for this quantity. Here you see I take V, no? not X. And I have this quantity coming from the POD. So I have computed the POD basis, so this is what I have. And the idea to compute, to investigate the a priori estimate, a priori error is something which is typical in Galerkin approximation. So what you do is you make a decomposition of the error in some part which lies in the space of the ansatz functions. There can also be finite elements. This is in finite element analysis, it's the same. And then some other part which is in the orthogonal space of this. But this guy here is covered by this quantity here. So this is done. So you only have to estimate this. But this is, as usually for Galerkin type approximation, is done by taking the evolution equation again and substituting this theta L. Then you use this for this definition. You play around and you get this this formula for this. Here in this case, it's linear evolution equation, so it's not too complicated what you get here on the right-hand side. Yeah? Okay, so let me point out that these formulas here are very similar if you go for reduced basis or finite element approximation. The difference now is here to POD that I can directly use the sum here for the RL. In the other techniques, you can use different approximations here, yeah, formulas. Okay, and what we get here is this result. Okay, as we see from the previous slide, there's some term on the right-hand side where we have this error in this snapshot with respect to the V star norm, and this also arises now in the error estimation of Y minus YL. So I have this snapshot, I have this this inhomogeneous ansatz, let's say, and then I can estimate it like this. But this gives me directly an idea. So, okay, what I want to have that this is in the POD snapshot ensemble, then I can also estimate this by the sum over the not modeled eigenmodes. And this is done by taking a second snapshot ensemble using the time derivative. Then I end up with this estimate. One remark, this hint to have this point clear. I take one u, solve for y, I take one u, compute this one u, and also compute the basis from this, and I use this basis to estimate this. So this is computed by this u, also this is no, this yl is computed from this u, this is written here, no? So you have this u going in there, and therefore everything is in the snapshot set, let's say, and therefore you have a rate in this case. If you do not have this, then you can prove also convergence. This is nothing else but looking for you have orthonormal basis of the space, so therefore you have some convergence properties. If this is smooth, then you can go for a convergence analysis, you get this, but you don't have any rate. Here, I mean, you compute the basis from some u, and this u tilde is some different u tilde from the control set, and then in this case, you have not this result, but you can have some convergence. We don't know how poor this convergence is at the moment. Okay, okay. And let me point out, the critical point is compared to, for example, finite element analysis is, as I already mentioned, the POD approximation quality. The POD approximation quality is only for the snapshot ensemble. In finite element analysis, you have approximation qualities for a class of functions. If this function is in H1, then you have some rate of convergence, and here maybe H2, no? And then you have some rate of convergence result. And therefore, in the finite element analysis, if this guy, the time derivative, is smooth enough, you can replace these rates there. In POD, you cannot if these guys are not included in the snapshot set. Okay. Other possibility is to treat the time derivative as right-hand side of the ODE and to apply this dime approximation. No? That is, no, also some viewpoint which is in relation to this error formulas. Okay.
Can I ask a question here? So in the last line, the D, what is the D, the little d?
This here?
Yeah.
This is a dimensional, in this case, you have infinite dimensional series.
So then it is an infinite dimensional series, so yeah. It means your covariance operator is trace class or something?
I mean, yeah.
This should be finite then, yeah? So
this is finite. This is finite.
How do you know?
This I know from this smoothness, I need smoothness of the y's and the definition of this R operator. Okay.
So the D is always finite.
No, not this D, but the sum.
The sum, even if D is infinite. Yeah. So then the sum of the eigenvalues is finite.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Okay. Picture, numerical result. So I take this linear problem and solve it, taking some U input. And what we see from this is that the separation of this ansatz, y hat and so, and su, helps me not much if the initial condition is smooth, but it helps me if the initial condition is discontinuous, let's say. And discontinuous here is we take the same condition here, but include some noise. And then, of course, in the POD model, taking this separation of this in the ansatz, I have this discontinuous discontinuous information already included in the ansatz, and this helps me in the convergence behavior here. No? That is what I want to mention here. Okay, let's go further. There are some extensions. Okay, you can go for the fully discretized problem. No? So replace the Hilbert space by some discrete space. You replace the time integration by some temporal scheme. Okay. You can do this for nonlinear problems as well if the nonlinearity satisfies some monotonicity properties, or that you can balance this. Well, that it is something which is also, if you look for the existent theory of these problems, related to these questions. No? So there's nothing which is not natural in this case. And there is some poster session, let me give a hint to this problem, where Oliver is treating an elliptic parabolic system which has relations to battery models which are investigated nowadays. Okay. You can do this a priori analysis then when you have the fully discretized problems. You can also do it with respect to the tooth approximation, so the error between finite element and POD solution. Okay, that is also more. You can look for goal-oriented approaches, like taking the snapshot so that you get a reduced order model which is as good as possible. Okay, there are a lot of things, let me also mention this balancing here, no, where you look for the properties you want to have a basis which is good for a dynamical system, which means you have some information also from on the observability information, that is this balancing. We come to this when we go for the optimal control problem. Some literature, I don't want to go into detail, but let me mention there are quite a lot of people working in this field addressing, for example, some of this extension I mentioned in the previous slide. Okay, let's go to the quadratic programming problem. So now we turn to optimization. Okay, so take a linear quadratic problem, quadratic cost, linear evolution problem, and we had before this equation. And this is my linear equation, and I have some control constraints here. Okay, I have control constraints, and I suppose that this is, I have a Hilbert space here, and it is usually in my presentation here, it is of this type. No? So we have some U space, which is Rn, so you have finite many controls depending on the time, or maybe you have some distributed control, or you have some boundary control. No? Okay. And again, this bilinear form is fine, so the evolution problem is well defined. And let me mention, in fact, you can do this, what we are doing now, also for elliptic problems. And elliptic problems means that instead of the time, which we treat here, now the parameter is the quantity where you do the summation here. No? So therefore, you have to replace this time interval by some integral over a set of parameter values. Okay. So and that what we want to do is, okay, we first look at this problem and recall, or let's say mention, what are first order conditions. First order conditions are, if you have a solution y bar, then you compute the adjoint solution to this equation, and from this adjoint solution you can set up a variational inequality. So you have state equation, there's a state equation, you have the dual information from the adjoint equation, and you have a variational inequality. Okay. And this variational inequality is nothing else but when you go for the so-called reduced cost. So I take this J, which depends on Y and U. I replace this Y by the solution operator and this particular solution. Then I only have a cost functional in U. Okay, and therefore this is a so-called reduced cost functional. And if I write down optimality condition there of this type, and this is nothing else what you have here. Now you can directly give a correspondence of this gradient of the reduced cost functional and the variational inequality. Okay. So let me remind, we had this variational, we had this particular solution, and we had this solution control to state mapping also for the POD space, no? So which means we solve non-zero, zero bound, initial condition, and here we have the problem where we only have the B here, so this is a linear problem in this U, and we take as ansatz functions the POD ansatz, the POD basis functions we have determined. Okay, and the POD state is now given by this Y hat plus this L SLU. But we have already done in this a priori analysis of the in this previous section is this. So we have that the initial condition is exactly satisfied, that we have convergence for a specific U with this rate. Yeah, and in this rate we have here the U, which is the same U here, and we can show some convergence of the solution operator, but we don't have any rate. Okay, so this is the state equation. And the adjoint equation is discretized in a similar way. So here we have the adjoint equation from the problem. And the idea is, again, there is some data which is fixed. There's yd. Let's treat yd as a fixed parameter in this case. Here's the y which comes from the state. This is not fixed. But the y can be written in the form y hat tf minus yd. Y hat of t plus this term. So this is nothing else but this term. And therefore, I see from this here that the p at the terminal time can be split also in an inhomogeneous part and some part which comes from the control. And that is the same idea as for the state equation, that I split also the POD ansatz. Okay? So I take p, let it write like this. So here's the dual equation. I introduce an operator A, which takes care only of this state here. No? As we indicated here, this is only the part which enters here. So the idea is now, okay, let's introduce an operator from the control space to the dual space, to the solution space, and the corresponding POD dual operator. And in this case, we can also write the P here in form of P hat plus AU, and PL is approximated like P hat plus AL times U. So same, and we use the same basis for state and adjoint. Okay, and what comes out is this. So again, we have this setting. And what we do is now we use snapshots. So first we take the state. So here the information from the homogeneous part. And here we take the part from the dual solution. I say P is nothing else but P hat plus AU. And PL is approximated by this. Then the estimate is of this type. In addition to the time derivative of Y, also we have, there's something wrong. This is more or less the same. No, it's just a second. There is something wrong. This should be yt, but here should be p. Here should be somewhere p. There's some missing. So, and therefore we get the idea as for the from the state equation, we have to include the time derivatives of the state variable and also the time derivative of the adjoint. And then we can prove an rate. But, again, no? In this case, the rate only holds if we take one U, and from this U, we compute this P and this PL. And this is, of course, in context of the optimal control problem, crucial because we don't have the optimal control. But anyway, in the best case, we have this rate. And we can prove, as in the state equation, this results there. The proof is more or less the same. So we have no rate, but we have convergence results. So what is missing is the variational inequality. So let us approximate the variational inequality, and it's straightforward. So this is a variational inequality, and we just replace this here by the PL, and we replace this by the UL, which is not done here, no? Which is not done. So there should be an L, there should be an L. So they are more or less the same, but only we have the, instead of U bar, here should be U bar. So this is copy and paste. No? So there should be an L here, so we have this inequality. So therefore, it's not so easy to see what I want to say here. The idea now is to get an a priori analysis, is to add these equations, these inequalities, by taking here, okay, here you have U bar, you take here U equal U bar L, and here you should have U bar L, you take here U bar. And then you can get a different sign, you can add, and you get this kind of inequality. Okay, we see here some term that you can put on the left-hand side, and you have to estimate this. And this can be estimated by this. And the interesting point is that there is some term which cancels out. And the interesting thing is this here depends, of course, on U bar L, on the suboptimal solution. But here we only have the operators, but here only U bar. And therefore, we can use the analysis from the state equation, where you have a fixed control, and you compute the corresponding P and PL. And for this, we have an error estimate on the previous slide. And therefore, we can end up with this kind of error estimate for the control. And in contrast to these results we earlier proved, we now have no additional terms corresponding to the initial condition. That is what cancels out. Okay, we only have this result here. Of course, when we here the basis is computed from the U-bar. If this is not the case, then we only can prove that there is convergence, but we don't have any rate. So that is, they can decay very fast, but the convergence here can be slow. Okay, that is what comes out here. Okay, so therefore, there is a need for a posteriori error estimation. Now we did a priori, so that is the error, so we need some a posteriori error estimation. So we have computed a control, suboptimal control, and the question is how good is this? And then from this we get the information, take more basis functions or change the POD basis. That is what is the idea here. And again, this is the variational inequality, and what we use is ideas which go back to the last century, so 97, in this, what we do here is, okay, so when we take our optimal, suboptimal solution, and we compute a joint which belongs to the suboptimal solution, and we plug it in here, then of course this is in general not satisfied, otherwise the suboptimal solution would be the optimal one if this is satisfied. So we expect that there is a misfit. But this misfit can be treated by introducing or making a perturbation of the cost functional, and this enters in the variational inequality by some quantity here. So we can take the suboptimal control here and compute this P tilde L, then there exists a perturbation such that this is satisfied. Okay, at the moment we don't know what this theta is, but what we can do is, as before in the a priori analysis, we can add them by choosing appropriate U and U here. So here U bar L, here U bar. And what you get is this result. It is similar to the previous one. And in fact, I don't give the analysis here. Here also something cancels out. You get such kind of estimate. You can estimate this U bar minus U bar L by this quantity. At the moment, it's not clear how to compute this quantity. Does this give me any information? Is this really a posteriori error estimation? Okay, so, and what comes out is you can do. So here again, this estimate, and here you have a direct formula. This is a direct formula. And you can compute it by, in fact, computing the gradient and then doing some mean max due to the control constraints. And what we have is we can prove, okay, if you take the exact basis, which means optimal exact solution, and compute the basis from this, then for the theta L, we have a rate. If not, we know that this goes to zero. Okay, that is what comes out here. And it uses the analysis from the a priori analysis. And this gives me an idea. Okay, we can compute this only without the knowledge of the exact control. And we have that this goes to zero if we enlarge L. And therefore, we can set up an algorithm where we say, okay, we do the model reduction. We compute in suboptimal control. We compute this theta, and we estimate, so we compute this quantity. If this is too big, we enlarge L and solve again. So we have probably several optimization runs on the reduced order model. And by using this quantity, we stop when we have a quantity which is sufficiently small. No? Of course, this here is nothing which is related to POD. No? You can also do it for different kind of approximations. You can also investigate the discrete case. Let me only mention that, of course, this is something where we use the POD quantities. No? Okay. It's one example where we see, okay, here, linear quadratic. Don't look at all the details. So what comes out is here we have the finite element controls. Okay, I should explain something. Okay, I should explain that the control enters on the, yeah, there on the boundary. We have a square. So we have four parts of the boundary. And in these four parts, we look for the evolution of the time. And therefore, we have here some four graphics, which four figures, which show this four parts of the boundary and the evolution of the control. And now we keep in mind, we use the control input and compute a basis. So this is crucial. And here you see the optimal control. And we see, okay, there is, no, what is, no. Okay, vice versa. This is the optimal solution, because here we see this constraints. Yeah, we have constraints. This is the optimal control, and this is the one I use for the computation of the basis. Now I take this, and then I do this a posteriori, and I enlarge, and so on. So, and what comes out is this here. So again, here is my basis computation from this U. And I see these are my errors. Here's my a posteriori error estimation. Here's the real error, so it fits, it is fine, but what we see is we have some stagnation here, no? So which means nothing else but the initial control is not good. Not only enlarging the basis is good, you should also think changing the basis. Okay, here the ideal situation, taking the optimal solution, and we see we get much better results here. Okay, we are in between. We cannot use the exact solution, but we should update to go in this direction. This is done by this example, and what you see here is the same. Don't go into the detail of the problem, but you see here, if you keep the basis and enlarge, you get, again, this stagnation. But if you use an update strategy by just taking the last suboptimal control, compute a new basis, and so on, you get a nice decay. And especially, you get that the a posteriori error estimation is a very efficient and rigorous estimation of the problem. Okay. Let me indicate here that we can use this analysis, previous analysis, for the linear quadratic problem to treat a mixed control state problem where we have some mixing here. And if you take epsilon equal to zero, we would end up with a control constraint problem. I would not go into detail here, but you can set up this as a control constraint problem. Okay, now I make a jump. You end up with a variational inequality, which is of this type, where you have here the transformation of variables. You do a transformation of variables, and you end up with a control constraint problem. Therefore, you can use the theory before, where we treat control constraint linear quadratic problems. But the problem is now that we have to also approximate these guys here. So there is some additional analysis needed, and you can do, okay? And what we get here is this picture. So they are similar to the example we had before, where we have only the control constraints. So what we have here is also, take a fixed U and look at the error, we get, okay, stagnation. No? If we do a basis update, we get this. If we use the optimal basis, you get this. Well, that's quite good in this case. And there is a misfit, you see, a misfit between a posteriori and ROM error. So this is ROM, the blue. A posteriori is above, so that is good. Yeah, but there is some error. This depends, of course, on the regularization. If we take epsilon bigger than here, then we are not so close to the state constraints. And we get that the error estimation is much more rigorous. So, of course, we lose some rigorosity there. But on the other hand, it's more non-linear due to the structure of the Lagrange multipliers in this problem. So it's maybe not amazing at the moment. literature make a jump to this nonlinear problems, and I would like to mention here two aspects. No, where, of course, as Matthias mentioned there, now we come to a capital where it's not like I present and then it's clear. There are a lot of focus, a lot of problems which has to be treated. And I have a first aspect, which is this idea. Maybe I will not give you all details, but this is similar in some sense to your Newton-Kontarovich theory. So where we say, okay, you apply an SQP method, or let's go to this. So you have this problem, you apply an SQP method for that. This means you set up the Lagrangian and you solve linear quadratic problems. And we have learned something how you may treat linear quadratic problems by taking the a posteriori error estimation of the previous section. That is the idea. And then you say your reduced order approximation, it can also be a reduced basis or balance truncation, your reduced basis approximation of this infinite dimensional problem gives you the inexactness of the method. And you treat this inexactness using the a posteriori error estimation to have the overall convergence of the method, like inexact Newton, where it is not necessary to solve the linear system exactly. That is the idea behind. Okay, so use the quadratic structure which is behind this nonlinear problem and use the previous one and use the contraction of this Newton method to get an overall convergence. Okay, so this is described here, and I also only want to show that you can derive convergence in this setting by using this inexact Newton theory behind and the a posteriori error estimation. So which means we have the infinite dimensional problem, we derive an infinite dimensional quadratic programming problem, and then on that we apply the reduced order model. This can be extended, of course, there are several possibilities, but one possibility is done in Darmstadt, where they treat the problem like this. You have this nonlinear problem, you derive this QP problem, and then adaptive finite element arises, they come into play. They do an adaptive finite element approximation of this QP problem, and on that, they do the reduced order modeling and control the error between reduced order and finite element and the infinite dimensional problem. That's quite nice. Of course, what you can also think, combine this with update strategies, not only enlarge L, keep the basis. We got some ideas also on this from the linear quadratic problem. Okay? So that is trust region, optimality system, POD. I haven't touched this, no? Especially this is not my, this is done in the group of Eckhard Sachs in Trier. We did some work on this are doing some work on this optimality systems, but I'm not touching this here, okay. Yeah, some examples, so there where you, in fact, you can see in this example that you have this quadratic convergence of the SQP at the end, maybe not at the beginning. Yeah, you have inexact Newton, so therefore it's not. Also some globalization is necessary in this case, so there's no quadratic convergence in the end. But you see, the a posteriori error estimation is also quite good to estimate the error, and we see in the last step we have some here, this gives me the error for the solution. So it's a way to go from linear quadratic to nonlinear problems, to certain nonlinear problems. Also here, application, this is a elliptic problem. This is not an evolution problem, just to mention this. No? Okay. Another chance is, this is the last thing I want to say, is you'll take the linear quadratic, the a posteriori error estimation for the linear quadratic problem and try to make it for the nonlinear problem. Okay, that is the idea here. So we have four control inputs. There are scalars. They enter here in this function. Maybe it seems to be a little bit artificial, but the idea here is that this nonlinearity arises in these battery models. And you can think about this is like a parameter in your system, and this Y corresponds in that way to the concentration. Okay, so 2D problem. Okay, and what we do is, okay, we use this solution map. We have a cost functional which only depends, the reduced cost only on the control, and we apply Newton-type methods to solve this. And in the Newton-type method, of course, you need the second derivative. You need the Hessian, Okay. And what you can do is, okay, you can estimate the error by this quantity. Again, there's a theta. The theta has, in this example, more or less the same form as before. This is something which is not surprising because the variational inequality is similar. But this eta has to be computed. This eta has to be computed from the exact one here. Okay, here we have a coercivity constant or a smallest eigenvalue of the Hessian, which is needed. Okay, this is not something which is surprised because it comes from adding again, and then you apply mean wealth theorem. That is what comes out. Okay, so there's something which is needed, and we are working on that to get some idea to treat with this. And we have two approaches. The first approach is, okay, replace this u bar by the suboptimal solution you get. You get a suboptimal solution and do an eigenvalue, compute the smallest eigenvalue. It turns out that this, of course, takes some time. We are faster than the finite element, but it's not a factor. The other one is maybe we look more in this reduced basis community and give an argumentation you can also do an offline phase. And that is what we are doing, and that helps. So we make a computation of the smallest eigenvalues before. And what we want to use is, we have a first test that it works, but what we want to use is, where we want to use it is in inverse problems. In inverse problems, here's the cost functional. They play around with this kappa, and they play around with this u star. Okay? But the Hessian has exactly this form. So if you have the smallest eigenvalues of this, you can directly set up the eigenvalues of the Hessian. Okay? So we make an offline computation of this, then we make some changes of kappa in the inverse problems, and we can directly compute this. Also, let me mention, this also depends only, there should be a U circle. It also does not depend on this. Now, the Hessian is independent of this, so this is also used in inverse problem, that you solve the problem, use the previous solution to get some regularization. So that is what we are doing, and we hope that then we have so much optimization solved so that in sum there's a benefit to have. But it is not done. No? Okay. Literature outlook is maybe something which I should mention at the beginning. This is what we have done. I spoke so long, so maybe you know what I've done. No? Let me mention, okay, we have to improve the online efficiency. No? As I said, we compute the theta by computing the adjoint equation. In fact, we also need the state equation. This will be addressed by the talk of Martin Greppel. Yeah? Yeah, okay. What is also of interest, this BOD error, we look only for the a posteriori error. Yeah? But which is also of interest in engineering science is to do feedback control, nonlinear feedback. For example, apply MPC techniques. There's an address in the talk of Alessandro Alla where we want to have an MPC scheme using POD and have some asymptotic stability. We look for an academic problem, but we can prove something here using the ideas from Lars Grüner and co-authors. I already mentioned the poster. The combination of a posteriori estimation and basis update is not clear. How to do this? When should we update? Because this is costly. No? In the work of Stefan Ulbrich in Darmstadt, there is a good idea to do this because they have this underlying finite element approximation. So therefore, they have sometimes to check the adaptive scheme, they have to solve the finite element model. You can use this information for a basis update, because in the basis update, usually the computation of the finite element solution is the main costly part. No? Okay, and what we also do is, this is something which is more now related to a posteriori error estimation for reduced basis approximation for linear quadratic problem. And I only want to mention that this idea in this coming up in this reduced basis community, parameterized PDEs, parameterized optimization methods, fits very well in a multi-objective framework where the parameters are also optimization parameters in, for example, a weighted sum approximation. And we are looking for that, computing a basis for the optimization problem and using this to make a multi-objective, of course, quadratic optimization, because we have the error estimates by Negi, Rozza, Manzoni and Quattaroni. So, thanks a lot. Ne? Wow, plus one. Perfect.
Okay, so already plus one, but if there are a couple of quick questions, we can...
So it's a general question that all the formulations and all the, I would say, variational settings mm-hmm. and the entire methodology of mm-hmm. this reduced basis is strongly Hilbertian. Yeah, so you are using Calhoun and Loew, everything is L2 based, you do minimize L2 type norms, etc., mm-hmm. etc. Yeah. So the mathematical structure, of course, of this business is in principle also possible when you have reflexive Banach, yeah, that you have some notion of angle between subspaces, etc. Yeah. So, but I'm not sure how much of these algorithms will survive, yeah, if you go reflexive Banach. And it could be relevant, for example, if you just take P Laplacian, for example, mm-hmm. with P mm-hmm. greater than 2. Mm-hmm. Because some of the problems that are interesting in applications have strong growth conditions mm-hmm. at infinity, which grow mm-hmm. super quadratically, mm-hmm. yeah, and then yeah. it will not work.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so let me say, as I mentioned at the beginning, no, POD will not replace finite elements or spectral method. That is not the idea what I have. The idea is that if you have certain structure, it helps to speed up solving the problem. That is, for example, you can also think in preconditioning. This is also something which is done in the group of Sachs, where they use this reduced order schemes to make some pre-computation and then going to the finite element or the full order, what finite element is one, your favorite method, no? To get some idea. So the idea is not to have a method which covers all things. But my experience is, of course, that, for example, with the battery model, no, that their industry is interested in having this. And this is the motivation from mathematical, there's a motivation for its own. But there is also a motivation from industry to go further. It's not, everything is not done, of course. No? But I think that is something we are not alone. No? So otherwise, we would spend the time at the beach. No?
Okay, so we're into the coffee break. Yeah. I'll suggest if there are more questions to come talk to Stefan, but let's thank him again for a really great tutorial.